Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, I welcome you in Jesus' name to this our celebration of Word and Sacrament on this 21st Sunday after Pentecost. We gather to deepen our understanding of what it means to live the Christian life of loving God and loving all God's creation. So come, let us worship God who loved us first. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God's kingdom now and forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We sing the hymn, O God, our help in ages past. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your mind and with all your strength. Jesus said, this is the great and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God and Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you,
we give you thanks. We praise you for your glory.
Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit,
the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, whose Son has taught us that love is the fulfillment of your law, stir up within us the fire of your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts your greatest gift of love, so that we may love you with our whole being and our neighbors as ourselves. To Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.
Amen.
We will now have the reading from Scripture.
A reading from the first letter to the Thessalonians. You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and been shamefully maltreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery. But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but to please God who tests our hearts. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with a pretext for greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us. You remember our labour and toil, brothers and sisters. We worked night and day so that we might not burden any of you while we proclaimed to you the gospel of God. You are witnesses, and God also, how pure, upright, and blameless our conduct was towards you believers. As you know, we dealt with each one of you like a father with his children, urging and encouraging you and pleading that you should lead a life worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. We also constantly give thanks to God for this, that when you received the word of God that you heard from us, you accepted it, not as a human word, but as what it really is, God's word, which is also at work in you believers. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Lord be with you, and also with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest? He said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them this question. What do you think of the Messiah? Whose son is he? They said to him, the son of David. He said to them, how is it then that David by the Spirit calls him Lord, saying, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If David thus calls him Lord, how can he be his son? No one was able to give him an answer, nor from that day did anyone dare to ask him any more questions. For the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. Your word that speaks of your great love for all that you have created. And even as we deepen our understanding of what it means to love you and to love all that you love, we pray that, Lord, you would open the eyes of our hearts to see this truth that you call us to live out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, in this season of stewardship in our parish, we continue to learn what it means to serve God faithfully and live with a deep commitment to the love of God that we've experienced in Jesus Christ. And so, as we continue to understand what it means to live faithfully, it is important, therefore, for us to recognize that each person who has committed themselves to God has accomplished and can accomplish something unique for God. In our reading from Deuteronomy, we heard how Moses could only get to see the promised land from the mountaintop. He could not enter it, even though he led the people for 40 years. But he dies knowing that God's promise would be fulfilled as the next generation of the former Egyptian slaves would enter into the promised land. Throughout history, there have been many people, champions of faith, who have influenced and changed, yet not reaped that harvest of what God called his worshipping children, his faith community, the church, to do. Keeping in mind that we approach the 31st of October, which is commemorated as Reformation Sunday, let me give you the example of Martin Luther and how his life and work and ministry influenced and changed the church forever. It was on this day, the 31st of October, in the year 1517, that Martin Luther, a young monk who served as a monk, a priest, and a lecturer at the Wittenberg University in Germany, was confounded by what he perceived as contradictions within his own faith and belief system and the activities of the established church of his day, the Roman Catholic Church. This led to the writing of his 95 thesis, which he nailed to the church door on the 31st of October, 1517. And so 500 years ago, Luther began the Protestant movement of the church, which eventually led to the different denominations of the Christian church. And even through these 500 years, both the Roman Catholic and the Protestant churches have continued to change and transform and evolve, but at the heart, they continue to keep as their foundational core the ministry and teaching of Jesus. Luther's influence brought many challenges and changes to the church, but one constant has been the teachings and the ministry of Jesus. For Luther, it was important that the people were able to read the Bible in their own heart language, and so he translated it into German. This was the foundation for us today, because Luther's influence eventually enabled each one of us to be able to pick up the Bible and read it in our own languages, in our heart languages. But for Luther, the key understanding for his faith was to know God's grace given through Jesus and his teachings of love. In the 22nd chapter of Matthew, from which we get our gospel reading for today, Jesus is still teaching in the synagogue, even though he knows that the Pharisees, the leaders of the accepted faith in the culture of their time, are trying to manipulate his teachings as if they were going against the recognized religious observances. These Pharisees pored over the ancient writings of Moses to look for every law in the book, and they were very scrupulous about the observance of all the laws. They counted up all the commandments of Moses and found that there were 613 of them. 248 of them were positive, and 365 of those commandments were negative, almost one for every day of the year. As Jesus is teaching the people, one of these Pharisees asked him, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" They were trying to see which one of the 613 that Jesus would pick. But quickly Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And a second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." Now, Jesus quoted from the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6, and also the book of Leviticus, chapter 19, verse 18, as he summarized the greatest commandments. And the scribes were aware that he was talking about scripture. How could the Pharisees therefore argue against Jesus' words about these commandments to love? These were experts in the law, and basically Jesus gave them the message of the laws of God in a condensed, easy to remember and understand version. Love God, love others, and love yourself. And so for a moment, let us now look at Jesus' greatest commandment. Friends, meaningful religion to Jesus was expressed in a triangle of love, or a love triangle. Love for God, love for others, and love for self. In this triangle of love is found the secret of a fulfilling life on earth, what we call living the eternal life here and now, and a foretaste of life to come. In it is found the key to understanding God's grace and the depth of Christ's love, and how we are to live with others and in relation to all of God's creation. An unknown Christian writer put it this way: our Maker gave us two hands, one to hold on to Him and one to reach out to His people. If our hands are full of struggling to get possessions, we can't hang on to God or to others very well. If, however, we hold on to God, who gave us our lives, then His love can flow through us and out to our neighbors. How full are our hands, and with what have we filled our hands, is the question. Luther picked this up, and so did our forebears, who looked at what it means to truly live in this love triangle. So what does it mean to love in a manner like Christ's love? And what does it look like? To understand this, maybe we need to think about loving the unfortunate in our world. It's the most beautiful thing, the love for those who suffer, for those who are poor, the sick, for those who continue to fail by the world's standards, and loving the most unlovely or unlovable. This is true godly compassion, and it touches the heart of God. And in loving the unloved or the less fortunate, we also make our relationship with God in that love triangle correct. Then there is the love for the more fortunate, not just the unfortunate or the less fortunate, but the more fortunate. And that's a very rare thing, to love those who succeed where we fail, to rejoice without envy with those who rejoice, to be happy for those who are happy, and be content even if you don't have as much as others. The love of the poor for the rich. Friends, this world is always bewildered by its saints. And then there is the love for the enemy. Love for the one who does not love you, but mocks you and scorns you and threatens you and inflicts pain on you. This is God's love, exemplified by Jesus on the cross. And it's a love that conquers the world with all its hate, with all its divisions. And it's a love that God calls us into that love triangle, exemplified by Jesus on that cross. And Martin Luther, 500 years ago, recognized the need for the people to know God and to love God, and not just religious observances, because of God's love for us given in Jesus Christ. 500 years later, the church still continues to listen to God, listen to God's word, be attentive to the Spirit of God working in our lives, so that we may be able to love like the way Jesus loved, and live in that triangle of love, loving God, loving others, and loving ourselves. And we do by following Jesus' two commandments, to love God and to love our neighbors. But the question is it possible to live out this love, this teaching of Christ? Or if it is possible, how do we do that? Yes, it is possible. And it is possible to share this love, because God's love never ends. much like Luther did by living and loving and listening to the Spirit of God to direct our lives. Luther's legacy is in the Reformation of the Church. As he knew it, and as we gather today to worship God, we do so also by singing God's praises and proclaiming that God is our help in ages past, our hope for years to come. And we continue to live with the knowledge that God is listening and loving us unconditionally. So come, let us continue to serve God faithfully with hope and praise. Let us rejoice with hope because God has called us and we have responded in faith. And we respond in love because God first loved us. Let us rejoice as we sing of our commitment to sharing God's love by serving one another in Jesus' name. Let me end with a prayer of a North African bishop some 16 centuries ago, a prayer from St. Augustine from around the year 400 AD. Let us pray. O God, from whom to be turned is to fall, to whom to be turned is to rise, and in whom to stand is to abide forever. Grant us in all our duties your help, in all our perplexities your guidance, and in all our dangers your protection, and in all our sorrows your peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, our body, our blood, our life, and our nourishment. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. A moment of silent reflection. Let us together affirm the faith of the Church.
We believe in one God. Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, to him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down to heaven. Was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became Jubilee. For our sake, he was crucified in the conscious planet. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he was raised again, and rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge the baptism and forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated for the prayers.
O God, your love for your children is without end, and you teach us to love you in return. Hear the prayers we bring for all you people. We pray for the peoples of the world during this global pandemic, for our neighbours whose lives are also impacted by poverty, homelessness, oppression or war. Help us to struggle for justice, peace and change with wise minds, courageous hearts and souls that thirst for righteousness. O God, teach us to love you, and in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for your worldwide church, for our neighbours of other traditions and faiths, for those with whom we eat at your table, and for all who seek to know you. Help us to wrestle with your gospel with inquiring minds, burning hearts, and souls that thirst for truth. O God, teach us to love you, and in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all in this community, for our neighbours with whom we work and play, for all who are disadvantaged, for our families, our friends, and for ourselves. Help us to persevere to build true community with enlightened minds, welcoming hearts, and souls that thirst for reconciliation. O God, teach us to love you, and in your mercy, we pray for all in trouble or distress, for our neighbours whose lives are filled with grief or despair, loneliness, sickness, or pain. We pray for, at this time, Chris Crawford, Derek Riley, Laura Peters, Kim Taylor, Keith Smith, Maureen Smith, David Weston, Matthew Weston, Janet Sin, Robin Forrest, Robert Nichols, Dorothy Bailey, Sheila Dawson, Marion Bray, Tom King, Linda King, Sean Hill, Brian West, Colin Valentine, Yvonne and Michelle Little, Sylvia Carr, Fiona Garrigan, Helena Pope. As we join as a community in prayer, loving God, please send your hope and protection to our friends in Christ, William and Elise Ness, as they search for their son, Dane. Give unto their family and to all those who search the blessing of your grace and love, that they may face each day with courage and hope. Help us to reach out to all who need us with understanding minds, generous hearts and souls with compassion. O God, teach us to love you, and in your mercy, we pray for your faithful servants of every age, for all who have followed your law of love. Expand our minds, inflame our hearts, and persuade our souls, that we too may worthily love you, and at our life's end, raise us up to share with you in glory. We remember the years mind of Doris Jean Chalice, Nancy Veronica Codman, Kay Jarman, Sheila Mary Jackson, Joseph John Booth. O God, teach us to love you and our neighbours as ourselves. Loving God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy, welcoming sinners and inviting them to the Lord's table. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Greeting of peace. We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. We sing our hymn of thanksgiving. Hail to the Lord's anointed, great David's greatest son.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All glory and honor be yours, now and always, mighty Creator, ever living God. We give you thanks and praise for our Savior Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine, and we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we eat and drink them, may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, we do as our Savior's commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord until you come in glory. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power are yours forever and ever.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, be confident to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins,
as we forgive those who sin against us.
Save us from time to time.
And deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and glory are yours, now and forever. As this broken bread was once many grains which have been gathered together and made one bread, so may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, Bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us your peace. Friends, for those of you at home and those of you here, I invite you now to engage in an active spiritual communion, believing that the mysterious presence of our Lord Jesus Christ is with you and with all of us at this moment. And as we remind ourselves of Jesus' words, I am the bread of life, whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. On behalf of you, representing you, I receive this communion in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you. Let us give thanks for the saving death and resurrection of Jesus and ask him to be with us at this moment. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. Since I do not now receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may I know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more dearly, day by day. Gracious God, we thank you that in this sacrament you assure us of your goodness and love. Accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and help us to grow in love and obedience, that we may serve you in the world and finally be brought to that table where all your saints feast with you forever. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. To Jesus Christ, our Lord, send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work and to praise him. Dear friends, thank you all for joining us in this worship. Some of you live and some of you through the gift of technology. I just want to say thank you to Tom and Helen for the beautiful music today, and especially Helen for that wonderful rendition of the Ave Maria. Really captured our hearts and minds of the beautiful story of God's love. And thank you so much for that song. Thank you, Elizabeth, for those beautiful prayers. And also Tom for reading scripture for us today. I want to thank Marilyn, David and Michelle, who came in yesterday and set up these beautiful flowers all in Geelong Cats colors. And as a way of saying, let's pray that our team wins tonight. But we just thank God for the way in which we can connect as a community, even through sport. And once again, thank you for these beautiful floral decorations that you have made possible for us today. Thank you, and God bless you. Have a lovely weekend, a long weekend, and may God's peace and presence continue to be with each one of us and our families. A moment of silence before the final blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.